In the first part of today's session on numerical methods, I would like to do a small excursion and discuss some results, namely Itô's lemma and the Feynman-Katz theorem, which are relevant then for proving the weak convergence of the Euler scheme. So you remember, actually, in the script, we are in the section on the weak convergence, on the convergence rate of the Euler scheme. But I, in the proof, I need these two results, which I assume you already know. But since these results are also important in other applications, for example, to construct numerical methods, I would like to devote a small section here on these two results. So we will discuss here Itô's lemma and the Feynman-Katz theorem. Okay, so. And what's important is that I like to give you an intuition for the two. Yeah, Itô's lemma, we already saw it in action when we discussed numerical schemes. It allows us to do a coordinate transformation of the stochastic process, so from a stock to the logarithm of the stock. Yeah. And this technique is, for example, important when you consider numerical scheme, because an Euler scheme for the stock is different from an Euler scheme of the logarithm of the stock. And you like to find a coordinate system where the numerical scheme has a very small discretization error, where maybe the coefficients are as linear as possible. So that's Itô's lemma. And Itô's lemma actually applies a function to the stochastic process and evolves this function forward in time. The Feynman-Katz theorem is actually maybe the opposite. It evolves backward in time, yeah, from a function of the final realization. It takes the conditional expectation and describes how this conditional expectation evolves backward in time. And this forward backward will later be used in the proof of the weak convergence. Okay, so let's start with Itô's lemma. So I have here on the slide maybe a fairly general version of the Itô's lemma. So we consider a stochastic process X, and this stochastic process can be n-dimensional. So by n-dimensional, I mean that the stochastic process is a family of random variables parameterized by time. So this is a random variable. If I plug in some omega, this is a realization of this random variable, and this is n-dimensional, so this is in Rn. And then I allow the stochastic process to be m factorial. So I use here the word m factorials for factors, risk factors, one could say. And m factorials means that the Brownian motion, which is a stochastic process two, which is used to define the Itô process, to construct the Itô process, the Brownian motion is m dimensional. So Wt omega is in Rm. Yeah, so that's m factorial. So that means that here actually sigma times dw. So if you think of the Euler scheme, it's delta w, it's a normal distributed random variable. Now it's a vector, m vector of normal distributed random variables. Then this is a matrix multiplication, and the coefficient sigma is a matrix which maps an m vector to an n vector. So sigma of t and say little x, yeah, is a matrix. So it is in R n times m. Okay, so this is a fairly general version of the Itô's lemma, because it already considers a vector valued stochastic process. So now we have given this stochastic process X. Dx is mu dt, so mu is also an n vector then, plus sigma dw. Recall that this here is just a short notation. So this all here is just some short notation. A short notation telling us that we can construct the stochastic process at a later point, say little t, by taking an earlier point, c initial value, plus the integral from 0 to t. And the first one is the back integral here, dt. And the second one is the stochastic integral sigma dw. So now sigma is a matrix, so everything here is component wise. So it's actually a sum of such stochastic integrals. But you can think of n equal to 1, m equal to 1, and you are in the the more familiar case of Itô's lemma. And now we apply to x a function. So there's a function g of t and x, so the function itself can depend on time. And this function here, so say this function g here, is d-dimensional. So we map it from an n-dimensional stochastic process to a d-dimensional stochastic process. So again, just yet another generalization. Yeah, you can also consider d equals 1. And what we get is then a stochastic process y, which is just g of t and x of t. And x is this stochastic process x. So plug in stochastic process x to get another stochastic process y. And for x, we know the short notation, the dx formulation, so how x looks like. And Itô's lemma tells us, if you apply a function, then I can tell you how the short notation, the dy, looks like. So Itô's lemma tells us how dy looks like. So dy should be something dt plus something dw. So here above we have a dt, a coefficient in front of the dt, let's call it the drift, and we have a coefficient in front of the dw, let's call it the diffusion. And now the lemma tells us, if you know the function g, I can tell you how drift and diffusion looks like. So here we see the dt part. If g depends on t, of course, the time dependence will introduce maybe another dt part. Yeah, so it's just dy is g. Yeah, so dg, and dg is just dg by dt, dt. Okay, but I don't see dw. We see here dx's. Okay, so there are the x's, and the missing dt and dw, you get them from putting actually this form here whenever you see a dx. So there is a dxi, so that means this dxi here, so let's take maybe a blue pen here. So this dxi is just the mu dt plus sigma dw, and now this is a vector, so take the ice component. Yeah, and so there you already have now a dt here and a dw again here. So you just multiply this out, you factor this out, and you get the form. And then it is first derivative of g with respect to x, yeah, so with respect to the second argument x, and then plug in the dx here. And The next one is 1/2 second derivative of g with respect to xi and xj, yeah, since it can depend on multiple arguments, yeah, it's n-dimensional, multiplied with dxi dxj. And dxi dxj is now obtained by factoring out mu I dt, sigma dw, the i-th component, multiplied with mu j dt, sigma dw, the j-th component. And whenever you get a dt, dt at zero, dw, dt at zero, dt, dw is zero. And the only thing that remains is a dw, dj, which gives us a dt if the two are equal, otherwise zero. So we can already write here that this part here is just all the dw i's hitting a dw j, where I equal j. Okay, so I equal j is maybe not the ninth letter here, because I use xi, and xi is a matrix multiplied with dw. So actually sigma is a matrix. So I have here some sigma I k in front of a dwk, and that one is multiplied with a sigma j, the j's component of x, which has also dw's, but only the one where the two agree will remain here. So it is sigma jk, the front of the dwk, and all those guys k from 1, 2. So now this is here our m, yeah, because we have m different Brownian motions, will remain. And what remains is then a dt. So we have a dt here. And you see we have another dt from that part. And this is maybe the only thing which looks a bit, little bit strange to you, because you see the first thing is just a classical, say, chain rule. Yeah. So this part here is just a classical chain rule. But then there's a second order term which comes from dw dw is equal to dt. Okay. The one-dimensional version, n equals 1, m equals 1, d equals 1. Maybe I write this here. Yeah. So special case. So d equals 1, n equals 1, m equals 1. So we have dx is, let's shorten the notation, I don't write the arguments, mu dt plus sigma dw. Y is g of t and x. So we have dy is dg by dt times dt. Then we get mu dg by dx times dt. Then we get the dt part from this second order term here. So we get, maybe I write this at a different place here. I need a little bit more space. Let's draw a small box here. So we get dy is dg dt dt plus mu dg dx plus this second order term, 1/2 sigma squared second derivative g with respect to x. So these two parts here are dt term, and we get the dw term. So that's the special one-dimensional case. So plus the dg dx sigma dw. Okay, so that's the special 1D case. Yeah, that's Itô's lemma, and very useful for us if we like to do coordinate transformation using a function g, yeah, which is allowed to depend on time. And I like to give you a little bit more intuition, yeah, why the lemma looks like this. As I mentioned, the first part here looks like a chain rule. Yeah, dy is dg by dx dx, just a chain rule. So where does this here actually come from? Yeah. So where actually does this strange rule here come from? And one little thing, yeah, which I sometimes use to explain this or also to get an intuition for myself is this little analogy, which I also like to mention here because it's useful and also much related to numerical methods. You can approximate a Brownian increment, so the delta w, with a Bernoulli distributed random variable. I just call it delta b. So Bernoulli distributed, we have two outcomes. Yeah. So in the literature, it's 1 and 0. But here, actually, I define two outcomes. It's plus delta, square root of delta t and minus square root of delta t. So it goes either up or down. Yeah. So I have a Bernoulli distributed increment here. And I define this as the delta b, and it goes either up or down, each with probability 1/2. Yeah, so that's now my little experiment. And what you have from the central limit theorem, actually we had the central limit theorem in one of our very early sessions, that if you take the sum of these random variables, yeah, so this looks a little bit like a Monte Carlo sum here. Yeah, so 1 divided by the sum of such increments, if they are IID, converges to the expectation. But 1 divided by square root converges to a normal distribution. Yeah, and since you know that the variance of the two independent variables is the sum of the individual variances, and I divide here by n, you see that the variance of this is just delta t. Okay, so maybe you are familiar from this from a Galton board, yeah, a so-called bean machine, yeah, which looks like this. Yeah, so maybe you know this. Yeah, so if you have binomial experiments repeated here, yeah, you get an outcome, and then if you take a look at the histograms of such outcomes and take the sum to infinity, then this approximates a normal distribution. Okay, so that's actually also the basis for other numerical methods, for example, like a binomial tree. Yeah, so if you have something like this here, a binomial tree, so you can approximate here going up and down. Yeah, and now you reach the new point here and you go up and down again. Yeah, so then you can maybe choose a time step size such that the two recombine. Yeah, there's a special choice for the time step size, such that up down recombines with down up. Yeah? And then you have all those guys here, they are just small delta b's. Yeah, so these guys are just small delta b's. So actually, you can write a stochastic process as delta x is, maybe you have some drift, mu delta t plus sigma delta b. Yeah, and many small delta b will actually give you a delta w. Okay, so you see actually the binomial tree is just an Euler scheme where the delta W has been replaced by the delta B. Okay, so why am I mentioning this? Because the delta B has a nice little property when you do elementary calculations. And I use this sometimes when I try to illustrate say properties of the Brownian motion. Recall that dw is equal dt. Yeah. So delta w, so a Brownian increment over a fixed time step delta t multiplied with delta w, this is not equal to delta t. But you have that the expectation, so the variance of delta w squared, yeah, this is delta t. And a nice thing for here, the delta b, the binomially distributed increment, is that actually delta b squared is equal to delta t. Yeah, so this does not only hold in expectation, you just see it plus or minus squared, yeah, it's a plus, square root squared goes away, so it's delta t. So if you consider a stochastic process where you approximate the d, the differential, the infinitesimal increment, with a delta, you do the Euler step approximation, and if you then approximate the delta w with a delta b, with a Bernoulli distributed increment, it's also a numerical approximation, and you actually have this result here holds with an equal sign and not in expectation. You can use this to get, for example, an intuition for Itô's lemma. Yeah, and this is maybe just a concluding remark. So getting some intuitions for Itô's lemma in discrete time. Given a stochastic process, so let's take the one-dimensional version of Itô's lemma. So we have some dx equals mu dt plus sigma, say dw. So I shorten the notation here. I don't write the arguments here. Maybe it's just a constant. So let's consider now the Euler step. So the Euler step would be delta x is mu delta t plus sigma delta w. And again, approximate so I approximate now delta x as mu delta t plus sigma delta b. Yeah, so we just have this Bernoulli increment, and now let's try to calculate Itô's lemma. So let y be equal to g of x. Yeah, so here is the stochastic process. So then Itô's lemma would give us, so what would Itô's lemma give us? So I can maybe copy the one-dimensional version here. So the g does not depend on t. So this is a dg dx dx plus 1/2 second derivative of g with respect to x dx dx, which is actually then a sigma. So here this would be a sigma squared dt, sigma dw, sigma dw. Okay, g does not depend on t, so the other dt term is not there. And let's try this here in this case where we approximate this. So let's calculate the delta y for this approximation. So the delta y for this approximation is actually g at a later point, so g at x plus delta x minus g at x. Yeah, so that's the delta y. Okay, then let's use a Taylor expansion. So we use a Taylor expansion. So we have Taylor expansion g of x plus h is g of x plus the first derivative. We need the first derivative dg by dx times h plus the second derivative. So 1/2 dg by dx squared, yeah, second derivative, times h squared. Okay, so, and assume this is finished, yeah? So either g is just a polynomial up to this order or there are higher order terms. So maybe there are higher order terms here. So if you use now this, what does it mean? It means that h in this Taylor expansion is just the delta x. Yeah? So h is just a random variable, namely the increment x. So we plug it in, we get this one canceled with this one. So I get dg by dx times delta x plus 1/2 second derivative dg dx squared delta x squared. So delta x squared for this guy here, yeah, so delta x squared is sigma squared delta b squared. So it is sigma squared delta t. Yeah? So this does not hold an expectation. This is exact. Yeah? Plus mu delta t squared. So mu squared delta t squared. And 2 times mu times sigma delta t delta b. So all these guys are of the order delta t to the power 3/2. Yeah, and you see that this here pops out from, if you have a random variable that goes up and down, yeah, the square only goes up. Okay, so that's the reason why you have this additional term. So you have here dg by dx delta x plus 1/2 second derivative sigma squared delta t. Yeah, so this is exact, yeah, not only an expectation, plus higher order terms. So all these higher order terms. So you have Itô's lemma here in using elementary calculation. Okay, and since going to the limit with the time discretization is like performing an expectation, so time average and space average, you arrive at Itô's lemma if you go to the limit time step size to 0. Okay, so that was a small illustration of Itô's lemma. Yeah, it's important for us. The second thing I like to discuss with you is the Feynman-Katz theorem. And maybe I also add a few minutes to give you some intuition for this. So what's going on here? So we have a stochastic process. So now it's just a d-dimensional stochastic process. X given. So each component follows here dxi mu I dt, sigma I, dwi. So now each component has its own Brownian motion, but they are maybe not independent. I allow that here for the dwi. The dwi, dwj can have a correlation. Yeah? So it is a rho ij dt. So you can either write it with a matrix, where then the correlation will pop out from this matrix, or you can write it like this. Okay, so I have a d-dimensional stochastic process. Every component in this d vector has its own Brownian driver, but the Brownian driver do not need to be independent. I allow that there's some parameter rho, such that dwi, dwj is rho ij dt. Okay, so that's the setup. So given this stochastic process, there's another ingredient, and this is here some function. So there's some function phi. So what color should I use for phi? No, I don't care. Let's take green here. Yeah, it's a function on RD. And in this function phi, I have it here. I plug in our stochastic process x at the final time. Yeah. So how does this look like? So you have here the time. You run until time t with your stochastic process. Say we start here. We run until time t with the stochastic process. And then here we have the function phi. So maybe take a green line here to illustrate this. This is my function phi. I take the value of phi at the endpoint x of t. So this here is my function phi at the endpoint of x of t. And from that, I take the conditional expectation. So I take the expectation of this. Given that we started with the stochastic process in time little t at the initial value x. So this point here is the point little t x. Yeah, so this is t and this here is x. Yeah. So we take the stochastic process, take in the Tx space a certain point, and from that we start simulating the stochastic process. Then we will hit this function, and from that we take the expectation. So we take the expectation of this phi. So we take here this expectation. Yeah, so we take the expectation of all those small light green values here. Yeah, we take the expectation. And this is different from, this depends from where we start. Yeah, so this depends from the point where we start. For example, if the point where you start is just, say, in the Tx spaces can be anyway, it's just here at the end point. Then for the stochastic process, there's nothing to simulate. So it's just a point. And the conditional expectation of this point is just a point. So if you go further back, yeah, the distribution becomes wider and wider. So you take more and more information from the function phi. And if you start here in the initial value, yeah, it's maybe just the expectation of phi of x of t starting at the beginning. So this gives you here now a function which we call v. Yeah, so the function v is the value of the conditional expectation. So do I have some color for this? I don't know. Let's take that one here. So we have a function v. So the function v is the conditional expectation of the final values which we create by starting in t and x. So it's a function of t and x. So that's the setup of the Feynman-Katz theorem. And the Feynman-Katz theorem now tells us that this function v fulfills a partial differential equation, a PDE, which is now here. So v is the solution of, so v is the solution of a PDE, namely that one. And this thing looks a little bit like what we saw in Itô's lemma. Yeah, it is dv by dt. So how does v change in time? Yeah, v changes in time because if you go further away, the distribution becomes wider. So it will take in more values from the outside of the function phi. Plus mu dv by dx. So if the stochastic process has a drift, it will move upward or downward. So it will take different values from the function phi. So this looks like a little bit like a shift in the function v. So it's multiplied with dv by dx. And then plus 1/2 gamma ij, second derivative of v. And this gamma ij is like in the Itô's lemma, is the sigma squared. But if you have here a correlation, then the gamma ij, the gamma ij here coefficient is the sigma I, sigma j, rho ij. Yeah? So if dwi hits dwj, you have a rho ij dt, yeah, and not a Kronecker dt. So instead of sigma squared, you get sigma I, sigma j, rho ij as a coefficient in front of the second derivative. So, and all this is equal to zero. So this is a PDE. Yeah? So you can say that dv by dt is minus the mu dv by dx, 1/2 gamma, second derivative dv by dx I dxj. Actually, if you know the heat equation, you see this guy. So how does it run? So it goes backward in time. Yeah. So this is a PDE where we have a final condition. Yeah. So this here is a final condition. I'm running out of colors here. Yeah. So this is a final condition. And we're running backward in time. So if you like to solve the PDE, you know the PDE at the end point, capital T, and you can solve it to, backward. Like the conditional expectation runs backward. Yeah. Okay, so while Itô's lemma described us, we apply a function G to the stochastic process and how does it evolve forward. Here we apply a function phi to the final value of the stochastic process and we define an object which runs backward. And this guy describes how it runs backward and looks very similar to how we run forward. Let's get an intuition for this. Also in discrete time, yeah? So we do some kind of Euler step approximation and I like to know why does this look like this? Okay, let's copy maybe the picture here. So what is our situation? Our situation is that we have some time here. Okay, so 1 second. Okay, so we have, so what's the situation? We have some time. At this point here in time, so what color did I use? I used the green one for the function, yeah? We have some function. So this function is actually the final value, capital V, of of capital T. So let's, for simplicity, just call it V of x. Yeah. So this here is a final function, V of x. So here you have the different values of x. We start at a certain point. That was here our red starting point, little t and x. Yeah. So that's here the t and the x. We simulate the stochastic process starting from this point. So we simulate the stochastic process starting from this point. We look where is x of capital T. Okay. And at these values, the blue ones, which are x of capital T, I now evaluate this function. So maybe there's a third dimension here. So this third dimension here is V of x. And there's some kind of function here like this. And you plug in the stochastic process, x of capital T, in this function V. Yeah? So in the previous slide, this was called phi, but now I just call it V, yeah, because I'm just looking at one time step, and V at capital T is the phi. Okay, so you get these points here, yeah, and from these points we will then take the conditional expectation. And I like to consider this now in discrete time. So let's say that this point here is T minus delta t. So I have one time step. So, and I go from t minus delta t to capital T with my stochastic process, and I evaluate this function. So what I do is I evaluate the function starting in x and adding a delta x. So this delta x is a random variable. X, little x, is the point where I started. Okay. So now I do the same as we did for Itô's lemma. Let's do a Taylor expansion for the function v. So you have a Taylor expansion for the function v. So v of x plus h is just v of x plus the first derivative. So this is dv by dx multiplied with h plus the second derivative. So this is 1/2 second derivative of v with respect to x times h squared plus some other stuff. Yeah, or you can assume that the function is just a polynomial, second order. So then I can just use h is equal to delta x. I just plug in a random variable, and you have that this is v of little x, the point where you started, plus dv by dx, the delta x, plus 1/2 second derivative dv by dx, delta x squared. So next step is we take expectation. And this expectation is now applied to this, given that we started in t and x. So actually, this is the conditional expectation. Yeah. Okay, so this means that if I take the expectation, this guy here is just the function here in the Feynman cuts, yeah, because this is the expectation conditional that you started there. So this is just the V of the point where we started. Where did we start? We started in T, capital T minus delta T. So that was where we started. Okay. And we started in little x. So that's this guy here, if you apply expectation. Okay, and on the right-hand side, I have just numbers in, it's just the little x multiplied with a random variable. Yeah. So this here remains V of little x. So, but the V of little x is the same as taking the expectation of V of t and x, because V of t and x is just a point. Yeah. So if your stochastic process starts here, it immediately ends. It ends there, and it's just the point itself. So I can write this, and then I just copy all the other stuff. So I have dv by dx. So now taking the expectation of delta x. So what is your stochastic process? Your stochastic process is we take an Euler step. Delta x is mu delta t plus sigma delta w. If you take expectation, it's just mu delta t. So it's just the mu delta t plus, okay, maybe just move this here a little bit down so it does not collide with the other symbol. 1/2 second derivative. Taking the expectation of the x squared. X squared is mu delta t squared, sigma delta w squared. Okay, that is a sigma squared delta t. Mu delta t plus sigma delta w. Yeah, so we get some other stuff here, which is a random variable, which is of the order delta t to the power of 3/2. Okay, so and now you can move this guy here to the other side. Yeah, so you have that one here moved with a minus to the other side. So I get zero is equal minus this one. So let's move this one here. Oops, sorry. Let's move this one here and write here a minus V t minus delta t x. Then I just divide by delta t. So divide by delta t. So let's write it maybe in different color so you see what we did. Just divide by delta t. Okay, and you see that this is dv by dt plus dv by dx mu plus 1/2 dv squared dv by x squared. So dv, so second derivative of v with respect to x, sigma squared. So this is just the PDE. Okay, so you see that the PDE comes actually from the same thing that this part here, the delta x squared, gives you this additional component. Okay, so that was maybe just an illustration of the Feynman-Katz theorem. Yeah, so we define a stochastic process that goes backward in time, or we will define a function from the conditional expectation of the stochastic process, or the function of the stochastic process, and this one goes backward in time, and we know the PDE, how it evolves.